buddy, not gonna lie to you, this is looking pretty rough. Yeah, you got pods that are talking to services they shouldn't even have access to. You got no ingress rules. Your DNS is just flapping all over the place. You got this sidecar container that's just crying. And I ain't even touched your network policies yet. Okay, so how much to fix it? Honestly, to fix this mess, you're looking at about 6 days, $3,000, and your cluster's sold. You know what? Forget it. I'll just fix it myself. What? You taking Alta 3 course or something? You're damn right. Trying to understand how networking works in Kubernetes can be a nightmare. Fortunately, we're going to crack open this nut and we're going to take a look under the hood with how Kubernetes networking objects works, how they connect to each other, what has changed, and what you need to know in order to implement it inside of your cluster. Let's get started. First thing we're going to do is we're going to make something that we're actually going to network to. This is the deployment. There's nothing sexy about it at all. I just want to point out that these are the labels that are going to be on the pods. They're going to be app Nginx demo. Make sure you remember that for later. Now, what this deployment did is that it just spun up two pods, both of which are running an Nginx image inside of them. That's not really important. But what you should notice is that both of these pods have their own IP addresses. Kubernetes gives every pod its own IP address. And the thing is that Kubernetes networking is flat, means that all pods can talk to each other by default. So what we're gonna do is that we are going to create another pod. The whole purpose of this second pod here, which as you can see is running a busybox image inside of it, is that we can actually execute curl commands. So I am inside of one of my containers at the moment. And inside of this busybox container, I'm going to send a wget command to the IP address of that very first pod. And check it out. What you're seeing is the index page of Nginx. Remember how I said that's what was running inside of our deployment? Well, the fact that we're seeing it from this busybox container guarantees that yes, we are accessing Nginx from another pod. So that's proof that this is working whenever you see it. Now, the thing about deployments is that if you should happen to delete them, like I'm doing right now, they will be recreated automatically. Now, the next thing to see is that those IP addresses are different. So if I were to go back inside of my original busybox pod and I were to run this wget command, obviously it's not working because that IP address is no longer valid. Just goes to show, just because you can do this doesn't mean that you should. We're gonna take a look at a much better option. That better option is this, a service. A service is kind of like a great big neon arrow that you would see like in Las Vegas or something. And it's just constantly flashing at pods saying, here it is, that IP address you're looking for, here it is. Inside of this service, you can see that in its selector field, it's pointing to app Nginx demo. Can you remember anything that has that particular label? Yeah, it's those pods that are being created by our deployment. Now, I just created that service, and what I'll point out that you can see here is that the type is ClusterIP. There are three different types of services: ClusterIP, NodePort, and LoadBalancer. ClusterIP is the most common type. It is used strictly for internal communication, so just pod to pod inside of the cluster. There's nothing external about it, and it's therefore the most common type of service there is. Anyway, if we were to describe this pod here real quick, take a look at, rather describe this service, take a look down at that endpoints line. Do you see those IP addresses that it's pointing to? And you see how those IP addresses are the exact same as the ones that belong to our deployment. Now here's something really cool. I'm going to delete all of the pods that you see up there at the top. And because they're deployments, they're going to come back. And as we've seen, they're going to have different IP addresses. But do you see that service? It's automatically grabbing the new IP addresses of that pod. So there's nothing that we can do to these pods. They will always have their IP addresses found. So now that we have a service created, let's make this busy box pod one more time. And this time, instead of running my wget command against a static IP address, I'm just going to call the name of the service. Check it out. It's still working. And this is the primary means through which pods talk to each other inside of a cluster. Okay, so ClusterIP services let us communicate between pods. But here's the thing, Kubernetes by default allows all traffic. It's peace and love, man. You can talk to anybody you want to, man. Yeah, nuts to that. That's terribly not secure. We need to come up with a better solution. So what we're going to do is we are going to learn about our next type of object, a network policy. So a network policy, I often describe it in my classes as being kind of like an overprotective parent. Like they've got their kid, their pod that belongs to them, or at least that's how they see it. And they're like, you can't talk to that kid across the street, or no, you can't talk to that girl down the road. You can only talk to that nice boy just down the other side of the street. So what we're doing with this network policy is that we are attaching it to a namespace, demo, and that's where our deployment was located. And what we're going to say is that all the little pods that have the label app nginx demo, you belong to us. You're my little pod, and my rules are what go for you. Now, the rules that we're setting are what ingress can these pods receive. App nginx demo, there's that label again. Those are pods that belong to our deployment. What would happen next is that we would describe where these pods allowed to receive traffic from. Clearly, we're not doing that, which means that this is what's called a deny all network policy. So if we were to create this network policy here, and if one more time we were to fire up this busybox pod, we saw that this was working just a moment ago, but when we run this wget again, it's hanging. And if we wait long enough, it's going to have like a bad connection message. So the network policy is doing its job. It is preventing any connection from occurring. Now, the thing about network policies is that they are incredibly granular, as you can imagine. You can be very precise about, oh, I only want to receive ingress from pods that are like this, or in this IP address range, or from this namespace. And likewise, you can set rules for egress, like you're only allowed to talk to pods in this range, in that namespace, with da-da-da. There's many different options on how to do that, but we're going to keep things simple. What we're going to do is that I'm going to add, just right here under the spec, a new section, which is now saying that all of my little pods inside of the demo namespace that have the label app nginx demo, you are allowed to receive ingress from any pods that have the label access granted, is what the new rules are. So if we go back down and we were to apply that deny all.yaml, the rules have changed. What we're going to do is that we are going to stop and rebuild this busybox container. But notice this time, we're going to put the label access granted on top of it. And as it turns out, that is going to be the secret sauce, that when we run this wget command again, this time it works. There's that nginx welcome page because we have configured the network policy to allow that communication to occur. So now we're going to start getting into some more complicated stuff. What we're now going to take a look at are ingress controllers. And ingress controllers are meant to just be another layer of abstraction on top of what we've already built. A deployment, a service that points to that deployment, and now we're going to be placing ingress controllers and ingress on top. This is just a tool that gives you the means of providing like more granular control over how access to that service and therefore your pods actually works. And the thing is that Ingress controllers are third party. There are many different ones to choose from. A pretty popular one is the Nginx controller, and I'll put the link down in the chat to this particular page. As you can see, there are many different ways to install it because there are many different ways to launch a Kubernetes cluster. But I'm going to go ahead and get this installed and set up. You'll just have to find the instructions that work for you and your setup. Now, once you get the Ingress controller installed, and once you've got your service and you got your deployment written, then you're ready to get started, right? Well, not so much. What I'm going to do is, in this diagram, we're going to work our way from the right to left to understand what exactly is running in my cluster right now, and then we're going to actually see it work. So we already wrote that deployment. It's running an Nginx image. And then we made a service that exposes that Nginx image. What we're going to do in just a moment is that we are going to write what is called an Ingress manifest. And the whole purpose of that is that if somebody were trying to access our cluster from an external URL, it will be redirected to that particular service. Now, in order for an Ingress controller to work, you do need to have a load balancer. If you are using a cloud setup, that's super easy. You're super spoiled. All right. They get spun up for you automatically in like EKS and GKE, right? But what I'll be doing inside of my setup is that I'm going to be configuring my Linux machine, which has Nginx installed as a service, to basically be its own janky little load balancer. It's going to listen for incoming requests, and if one of those requests goes to a particular port, 2224, that will be redirected to our node, to the Ingress controller, to Ingress, which will then go to our service. Clear as mud? Well, you'll see what I'm doing here in just a second. But the base URL, that first part, is going to be this really weird URL I'm going to show you in just a minute. So that really long and strange URL that starts with aux 1. I work for Alta3. We have our own training platform. And this is the unique URL to my setup that I have that is connected to port 2224 on my local host virtual machine here, Beachhead. Basically, what I want to do is that if I go to that particular URL, I want it to point straight to my deployment that's running inside of my cluster. What I'll be doing inside of this lab is, and this is just unique to me, this is not necessarily something that you have to do inside of your own setup, is that I am configuring Nginx on my local beachhead so that it is listening on port 2224, and it will send upstream that traffic to either of the nodes inside of my cluster, node 1 and node 2. That 30934 number that you're seeing, that is a node port. Remember how I said there are multiple kinds of services? A node port is another type of service, and what it allows is external communication. And what I've got on my screen here is a quick output of our Ingress controller that I got installed when I installed it inside of my cluster. Take a look under ports. Do you see how next to 443, that in Nginx, that is its HTTPS port? 30934. That's the node port that I had configured my load balancer to redirect to. So that's just what I'm doing for this to work inside of my environment. As long as you've got that mapped, it'll work. Okay, so what I'm showing you here is that I'm just keeping myself honest. That pane up at the top, which is student at BCHD, Beachhead, that is a virtual machine that is not part of the cluster. It is not a node. It is just a workstation, right? It has kube control installed, but that's it. I'm going to use this curl command against that aux 1 URL. And inside of that deployment, we swapped out from Nginx to something else. Just a little message that will make you feel good when it works. It works. Okay, and now we're going to be getting into our last topic, gateway APIs. We are now at the tip of the pyramid that we've built our way up since the beginning, that we started with our deployment, which we exposed with a service, which we controlled with a network policy, which we were then able to expose externally with an ingress controller. And now here we are at gateway APIs. Gateway API, very complicated, and also still kind of in the news side of what's going on with Kubernetes as of right now. When you are creating a gateway API, you are actually making multiple objects. The ultimate goal, ultimately, is to be able to have a lot more control, like in granularity over routing and like what it is that you are allowing, like extensibility and multi-tenancy. It's a whole bunch of things. But if you just want to see how it works, that's the purpose of this video, and we can get into greater detail in another one. Let us know down inside of the comments. So you can see from this diagram here from the Kubernetes documentation itself, the only part of this picture that is missing is, in our environment, a gateway and HTTP route. Like when we were working with Ingress, in order for you to be able to make these objects, you need to have gateway API Ingress controller compatible installed inside of your cluster. That's maybe easier said than done, but there are a lot of different third-party versions out there. You're going to have to go with the one that works for you. So what we're looking at here is a manifest for a gateway. So you can think of this as kind of like a router or like an entry point for incoming traffic. First, I want to point out that gateway class name Nginx would imply that, yes, there are many different types of gateways you can write from the many different types of gateway classes that there are. They are third party. What we're also configuring here is that our gateway is listening on port 80 for incoming HTTP requests. And what we're also having here is just a little measure of security, is that we're only accepting requests that are from things on the same namespace as this particular gateway. And this is our HTTP route, which is really a lot like the Ingress manifest that we made earlier, where its ultimate goal is that it's able to direct traffic, that if it's coming into like this particular route, then it's going to be sent on to a particular service and then further on to a particular pod. So what we're doing here is that we are referring back to the gateway that we made inside of the previous manifest. Our host name is web.example.com, just as a quick throwaway. And for our backend refs, aha, remember that service, Nginx service. That's what we're going to be pointing to. And that's what we are going to test and see, can we make a connection to that service through this API gateway now that we've created the HTTP route. So to test this, here's what we're going to do. First, I'm going to describe the gateway service, which you'll notice is the third type of service that we discussed. This is load balancer. So for a Nginx gateway to work, or any gateway, it needs to be a part of a gateway compatible Ingress controller. Ingress controllers, and therefore API gateways, do sit on top of and use load balancers. What we're going to do as a little workaround is that I am going to grab that node port that you see there next to port 80. So that's HTTP. And what I'm also going to do is I'm going to grab the IP address of one of my nodes here. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to write out this curl command to that URL that we were looking at, web.example.com. If I put those together and then we try that out, nice. Oh, learning all this stuff is hard enough, but also trying to like get together a dependable environment to do it in, as well as, you know, maybe some really clear instructional labs that tell you what to do, as well as plenty of support, as well as certain handsome instructors that make all sorts of really easy to follow videos. You can find all of that if you click on that link down inside of the description, Alta 3 Academy, where you can try us out for 3 days for just $3. All right, gang, I hope that helped. Make sure you like and subscribe if you haven't, and I'll see you next time.